Indian Express Group. We have with us today Professor Ashis Nandy, one of the leading public intellectuals of our times. A clinical psychologist and sociologist by training, Professor Nandy has written widely and with acuity about Indian society and politics. He draws on significant and very deep reading of news and history and popular culture. And no matter what he writes on, he always provokes and he challenges. Professor Nandy will be in conversation today with Vandita Mishra, our national opinion editor, and Prateek Kanjilal, literary editor. Before I hand this over to Vandita and Prateek, I would like to thank our presenting partner, Yes Bank, our associate partners, HP and Ballantines, and hospitality partner, Claridges. Thank you.
Hi. I know that Ashis Nandy enjoys listening to descriptions of himself because they are never the same. He is many things to many people, and just about the only element that is common between these versions is that everybody agrees that he is provocative and he is controversial. Now, he has been controversial for about from the 1970s, I suppose. Yeah, he has. In fact, the first controversial text concerned a sati epidemic in 19th century Bengal. And there's this, you know, Ashita does not routinely explain himself. If you asked him, who are you? He would probably say, you tell me, because he wants to hear your version. And he also does not he does not readily explain where all these controversies come from. But in one book, which I'm sure very few of people here would have encountered, he does. That's in Bengali. He ventured into Bengali publishing in 2016 with a book called Putpath Perule Shomudro, which is cross the footpath and there's the sea. It's a series of conversations. But in the introduction, he has really, for once, explained himself at length. And he talks about controversy thus. This is a very loose translation. I have been found controversial generally where the evidence for the basic thesis is visible all about us, but its validity is not acknowledged in polite society. It is presented in public in the ghungat of some fragile, dated, imported ideology or theory. So that's the rubric of controversy. Now, that first controversial text in the 70s concerned sati. There was an eruption of sati in 19th century Bengal. And in the course of the discussion, he was taken to be a supporter of sati in the 20th century, which was quite difficult. And he says, I was forced to ask 45 years later if we really did not know more than that more than half the cases of sati occurred in Calcutta and its suburbs, or that it was happening mostly in the small Savarna community, or that it owed to widows acquiring some property rights of custody. So the conclusion he comes to is that the origins of sati may not lie in ancient custom, but in the modern concept of profit and loss. Now, similarly, I would like to ask, is Hindutva similarly explained? Is it also a modern urban concept which claims antecedents in antiquity, but is actually completely modern, completely urban, and actuated by influences from the globalized modern world?
Yes, it's absolutely product of modernity. It is driven by the search for a proper nationality, which the kind of Savarkar believed India lacked. Here was one country which had no nationality. And the modern world runs on the concept of a nation state, which requires a nationality and nationalism. Nation state, nationality, nationalism. And because we don't have a nationality, and because Savarkar felt that we are burdened by these Hindus multiplying like flies, but demartialized, effeminate, disorganized. We have to beat them into a modern nationality. That was his project. He picked it up from Europe. And this search has never left us, because there is the other view, somebody like Tagore, who said that we do not have a nationality and we are none the worse for it. We have people, we have communities, and these communities are not only confined to the social sphere, there are different kinds of community. One person is associated with so many communities, and according to context, that community becomes relevant. So we do not have to have either a nationality or that ideology of nationalism. Old-fashioned patriotism is good enough. As it happens, in Europe too, an idea of nationalism is not more than 250 years old. When the monarchy started collapsing in Europe, the European elite were worried that how will we hold the countries together, because the ruling dynasties, the royalty, had both a temporal and a sacred role. They mediated between the heaven and the earth, and therefore they were automatically the reservoir of charisma and symbolized the people. You not only owed allegiance to the king and the country, you died for the king and the country, king and the country. But now, in the absence of the king, would we have that allegiance? So nationalism was propagated by the states of Europe as a necessary part of statecraft.
But Professor Nandy,
just 1 minute, I will complete this, because this part of the thing is clear. This also means, also had automatic another implication, because European elite who propagated nationalism for their own people never went by nationalism themselves, because the aristocracy always intermarried, and this was such common thing, because Europe is not that highly populated a place. So when Queen Victoria had his golden jubilee, 110 royal families were represented at her reception. All were related to her from all over Europe. So nationality applied only for hoi polloi, people like us. The rulers do not have true nationalism, because they have a larger role to play in history. So there you are.
Yeah, Professor Nandy, if nationalism, as you describe it, is a borrowed, imitative project, and it is born out of an inferiority complex, and it is also about a crisis of masculinity, what accounts for its resilience? It's in India, for instance, long after the colonizers left us, what accounts for its endurance here as well as in other countries around the world?
That also has a story. I don't want to give long answers, but you are asking questions which are pushing me to do so. Old-fashioned patriotism was good enough for even Europe at one time. And in India today, it is by blurring old-style patriotism, love for the country, which is natural and biological, and idea of nationalism, we have tried to strengthen nationalism. Nationalism by itself does not make that much of sense as old-fashioned patriotism, which is biologically given, in the sense that your earlier learning induces you to love your environment, your place of your location. And even cats and dogs are territorial. Even birds are territorial. You know, that pigeon mail which was sent was an attempt to use the territoriality of birds. So it is not species specific. It is not only a feature of human beings. It characterizes lower animals too. And people died even then for the king and the country. So they were patriotic. And I think every Indian, every South Asian, I should say, is patriotic by nature. That is given to them. So you don't have to teach them to be patriotic. But nationalism is an ideology. And nationalism not only is defined by love of the country or territory where you are born, nationalism is defined by specific enemies and specific allies. A Turkish psychoanalyst argues that this attempt to find enemies and attempt to find allies is a basic human need. And from childhood, there is a temptation to find that. So nationalism is built on that. Patriotism doesn't have that kind of a responsibility. It doesn't have to define your enemies or define your friends. So a different kind of relationship prevailed between countries which even they had wars. Like the Mahabharatic wars, every day after the battle, the enemies met in the evening and talked of the older days when they lived together in peace. All the days of the battle, this was a common feature. So it has a very long tradition. You will find similar stories in the West, similar epics also in the West, that there was a different kind of definition for enemies and allies. Nationalism introduced a newer concept where the enemies are more clearly defined and allies are clearly defined, and all nationalists are supposed to agree with that, and that's the problem.
Our own brand of nationalism is a little paradoxical, isn't it? On the one hand, it uses temples, Ram Setu, all kinds of archaeological sites and histories as a basis or an anchor, a sheet anchor. But at the same time, its founding fathers were not believers. Savarkar certainly, you know, he really flaunted his atheism, and Hegdevar and Munji, these were not, I mean, they didn't want belief first, as far as I know. And the first was Golwalkar, I suppose, who clearly spoke of the Lord and so on. Isn't that a little paradoxical, that the roots are in atheism?
You know, even when these themes are invoked, I don't think the context is accessible even to those who use these symbols. You mentioned Ram Setu. Let me mention, therefore, how Kannada Ramayana describes Ram Setu. I know that because it is in a Yakshagana play, this is acted out. In Kannada Ramayana, after the Ram Setu is built, the monkey brigade told Rama that this Setu will not survive unless you do a ritual yajna and sanctify it. So if you want to invade Lanka through Ram Setu, you have to do a yajna. But in that part of India, there was no Brahmin. No Brahmin to do the yajna, except one. And that was Ravana, the king of Lanka. So in desperation, they wrote a letter to Ravana that you come and do the perform the yajna. Request me, can you please do it for us? Ravan knew what it will mean to him and his family and his country if the Setu becomes long-lasting. But he was also a Brahmin and felt it obligated in the absence of any other Brahmin to perform the yajna. So he accepts the invitation and comes in disguise to perform the yajna. But the disguise had no meaning because everybody knew who the man under disguise is. So came, performed the yajna, went back unharmed, but knowing fully well that he has contributed to the destruction of his own family, probably his kingdom, and also his own life. It will now in jeopardy. That was the concept of enmity, and that concept of enmity has been now superseded by a different concept of enmity, where there is no ethics defining the limits of enmity.
You've written and spoken about the distinction between Hindutva and Hinduism, and you've said that it is a fight to the finish and that Hindutva will kill Hinduism in the end. Do you still maintain that, or have you had opportunity to revise this?
I think ultimately Hindutva will survive. It is too decentralized, too much open to diversity. Hinduism. Not Hindutva. Hindutva has won. I mean, not only Hindutva is one, I can also tell you that all nationalism are the same. You read nationalist texts. I have worked on nationalism, so I am telling you with some confidence. You read whatever nationalist text you can get, and you should tell me that this nationalism is different from our nationalism, or that nationalism is distinct from other kind of nationalism. You cannot find this. All nationalisms are same, the texts are the same, only the names, only the minor trivial details differ. There is no difference between nationalism anywhere. Psychologically speaking, they are absolutely the same, profile. That is the difference. Whereas patriotism is different from country to country. Some are patriotic only about their village. Some about the country, some about the region, some about the language. So how you define patriotism differs from country to country, situation to situation.
But you've also spoken about Savarkar's utopia as the most boring place on earth, where there are only Hindus, where the minorities have been exiled, there is one language, one nationality. Now we have one constitution, one tax. So are we moving towards Savarkar's utopia? Have we already become that?
Yes, this is Savarkar's state to some extent, I would say, to a great extent. Savarkar was a great admirer of Western nation states. He was a translator of Mazzini, and he felt our salvation lay there. But yes, his utopia, I mean, I must say that as a non-Hindu, I was felt very obliged to him for keeping the minorities away from it. In his ideal India, there is no Muslim, no Christians, no other community except Hindus. And each Hindu is marrying outside his caste. You have to, there is no caste technically, but you have to have caste for them to intermarry or the different, you have to recognize language for them to marry over the language barrier.
And there's no dissent and no humor either.
None whatsoever. It is the most boring utopia, and I felt very grateful to him for keeping the other the minorities out of it. So I was at least out of it. More interesting is the fact that his three main arguments against Gandhi. He said Gandhi was superstitious because he tried to bring things like soul force and fasting into politics. Two, Gandhi was anti-science because he talked of multiplicity of science and alternative sciences, alternative technologies, charkha, etc. And three, Gandhi was not, had no knowledge, was innocent about or ignorant about or modern Western political theory. Yes, I would agree with him. All three are right, though I personally think these are the things which gave strength to Gandhi and made his descent survive all competition. I mean, he seems much more relevant today because the movements we see around us on environment, on feminism, on peace movement and so on and so forth, they all owe allegiance to him. Even his alternative science and technology, I remember in 1990s, a collection of global scientists, some of the best known scientists of the world, issued a statement on the situation of the world. The only person they mentioned was Gandhi by name, only person. But that's not the point. The point is this, that Gandhi himself, I have found, was one of the best read person on dissenting political theories and dissenting political movements in the West. So in one sense, his knowledge of modern Western political theory, as Savarkar defined it, had to be poor. Though Savarkar was very much influenced by the political theory of some of the, what you might call, fascist elements in European political scene. And that's why his writings now have a clear touch of, clear impress of 1920s and 30s, which is not the case with Gandhi's. Gandhi's has a kind of, with all his eccentricities, has survived as one of the, even his writings have survived better than most others. But that's a different story. I don't want to go into that.
You've also talked of you've written about the many Gandhis. I remember an article called Gandhi After Gandhi After Gandhi. I just sort of trailed on. So is that multiplicity of, you know, that multiplicity of facets, does that account for his survival?
That's also the clue to his survival, because people rediscover new kinds of Gandhi. There are many Gandhians who are extremely boring. I have met Gandhians who every day drink a glass of Nimbu Pani in the morning, because Gandhi had once told him that, you know, that's good for health. Gandhi himself might have moved away from that. That's a different thing, you know. So I have met Gandhians who will not experiment with anything new, because they want to duplicate what Gandhi did. And Gandhi was a very, you know,
that's a kind of dogmatism.
Huh?
Whereas
yes,
Gandhi was very open.
Yes, that gives them a sense of security in Gandhism. Whereas Gandhi himself
element to it.
Didn't seek security from his ideas. He didn't believe in any ideology. He had no obligation to be self-consistent. And he, like, for example, the well-known example when Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan visited Sevagram. Somebody said in front of Gandhi, and so Gandhi was telling to Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan, "Why are you losing weight?" So somebody standing next to him said, "What do you expect him to do? You are feeding him all this grass and other vegetables. He is a Pathan." So Gandhi said, "What's wrong? If he wants, is a Pathan, and if his health requires that, let him have meat." Ghaffar Khan said, "No, but I don't want to eat meat in the ashram. I am happy as it is." So somebody said, "Why don't you give him? There is something called unfertilized eggs. Why don't you give that to him?" So Gandhi said, "Oh, that's good. I didn't know this. So tomorrow you give him eggs to eat, and I shall also eat that because it is non-vegetarian eggs." So then they were very upset. They said, "No, in ashram, if you take it, it doesn't look nice. He can take it." Ghaffar Khan said, "No, I don't want to take it, but why do you want to take it?" He said, "No, but I don't. If it doesn't have life in it, it is all right." So they said, "No, doesn't look nice." He said, "All right, if you all insist, I will not eat it, but from tomorrow, this Devdas will eat it, his son. Devdas will eat eggs, this non-fertilized eggs." So he was always willing to experiment. He had his many facets, and people picked up those aspects of Gandhi which they felt comfortable with. At the moment, the official Gandhi is the Gandhi who is a saint, whom you should keep on your shelf, a statuette or a portrait, and garland it every day. And when it comes to your life and your public life, particularly public life, then you say, "That's a saint. His life was different, his concerns were different. We cannot follow that." Yeah. That's the easy way out. That's why I never use any honorific with Gandhi. I've never written in not one line you will find Mahatma Gandhi. I want to reduce him to a human being. I might say so, stood in his shoulder, and I found the shoulders not as fragile as I thought, and I have been able to look much farther and examine myself much more courageously than I could have otherwise done.
Professor Nandy, you said you tried to humanize Gandhi. You've also tried to humanize much more unsympathetic figures in history, like Godse, for instance. You've also looked at the psychology of the suicide bomber. In a global environment, climate that has changed after 9/11, is it an increasingly difficult project to humanize the villains of history or the more unsympathetic figures of history?
It is true what you are saying, because enemies and allies are becoming more and more impersonal entities. You cannot identify your enemies clearly. You cannot identify your allies clearly, because nature of social organization have changed. And I think that human touch is often missing, because you don't have the opportunity to see other part of the story. If you allow me to say so, I will say that Gandhi wrote the scenario of his own death himself. In fact, there was a seductive thrust to his later day life, when he is virtually inviting assassination, because he knew that he is, as a living person, he has exhausted his possibilities. But if he could, in a confrontation, die in the hands of the Hindutvabadi, in some deep sense, he has justified his justified and legitimized his vision and his hope about the future of India. And that is what happened, because Godse was in some sense an innocent toy. If you read the life of Savarkar, you will find that Savarkar had many such disciples who killed for him and were then disowned by Savarkar. You know, I mean, this is also true. The lawyers representing Godse and other accused of the Gandhi murder trial writes in his own autobiography that Godse pined at least for a sign of recognition on the face of Savarkar when Savarkar passed him by, because they were also in the same courtroom and same row where the they were being tried. But Savarkar did not. He said before dying he would have wanted at least one word of sympathy from Savarkar. Savarkar never showed the courage to do so, lest he be identified by the conspiracy. But that's a different story. So Godse, in some sense, was also a young boy seduced by Savarkar, and Gandhi, in some sense, sensed it. And it is not an accident that Gandhi's children also guessed it, and they asked for clemency for them. Not clemency, but at least the relief from death penalty for these two young men.
You have said somewhere fairly recently that in the public space, self-righteousness has replaced self-criticism. Self-righteousness has replaced self-criticism. Mm. If that is so, then India seems to be in the throes of a search for identity all over again. Mm. But if you have left self-criticism behind, if you're certain of what you're doing and who you are, can you really find yourself? Can you find your identity anymore?
That's a difficult question to answer. It depends on the person.
Yeah.
And depends on the kind of issues he's subconsciously going to grapple with. It is true that in some things you just cannot access yourself, because in some sense to access them or acknowledge them will jeopardize the stability of yourself and a personality. For example, let me give an example from my clinical past. That once there was a case in, this was in Ahmedabad, of a young boy who seemed to have, according to the person who was seeing him, clear signs of hysteria. Hysteria is something which you can find in India even now. From the West it has more or less vanished. And Freud's early work was a hysteria. So they have great problems in finding a hysterical present to show to the students. They have to come to India or other parts of Africa, some parts of Africa and so on and so forth, to find a hysteric present. But India, there are plenty of them. Now, this person, after saying this, said that I would not like to grapple with this problem of hysteria. This was my PhD guide. He said, I would like to, because if I enter this issue, this hysteria is a defense against schizophrenia, which is a much more serious disease. And I do not want to disturb his hysteria, because it is acting like a defense against this schizophrenia breaking out. So I would let it go. let him live with his hysteria. That's a much, it's a minor element compared to schizophrenia. So there is that part of the story also. Depends how much you can look within and how much you are capable of looking within, how much you should look within.
Do you see hysteria or schizophrenia in our political culture?
Pardon me?
Do you see hysteria or schizophrenia in our political culture today?
No, schizophrenia, there can be, schizoid responses are there all over the place. No, but here India, that is not the main thing. At the moment, previously, the main thing you came into contact with, the most frequent referral was obsession compulsion. Well, that was. Now, at the moment, it is depression. And I am very depressed thinking of that. In Srinagar Medical College, they had two beds for mental illness. Mental illness. The present estimate is this, they need 1500 beds. And most of these patients that in Kashmir, they have depression. It's a depressed society almost.
Professor Nandy, one of the themes in your work has been the nature of violence, public violence. Hmm. And you have said that it has changed, that earlier if it was defined by hate and passion, it is now defined by the absence of hate and the absence of passion. That there is a certain, it's almost an industrial operation. It's yes. It's an accountant's violence where you tote up the profit and the loss. Yes. But where in this definition of violence would you locate lynching, for instance? Is that the return of hate, the return of passion, or would you still say it is, the accountant's violence?
I would say it is a return of passion. And I have more hope with that than with the other kind of thing. Because in 20th century, this other kind of passionless, and if I may so, hateless violence has come to dominate the scene. It was first noticed, by the way, by Tagore. Tagore was once going, when he was going to Iran, he wrote a book on it, Parashya. And there are two, three sentences there. He, part of the way he flew, and I think the pilot, if I remember correctly, the pilot was one who has participated in the Afghan war. And while he was traveling in the plane, the pilot explained to him the beauties of aerial bombing. And it struck Tagore that here, from this 20,000 feet or so, if you can kill somebody there below in the Afghan villages, it doesn't touch you at all. You don't need any hatred. You don't need any anger. You are just pressing switches and killing people. And this distance between the victim and the perpetrator is going to be a dangerous development in human affairs. The best example I can give you of this was in that film on Vietnam, based on Conrad's Apocalypse Now, where the helicopter gunships from the top are strafing a village. So when you go down the village, you see the men, women, children, they're running. They do not know where, because this machine gun fire is from the, it's with so many helicopters fire. And even the cattle are running with them. And then you go up and it is serene. And they are playing on the stereo system in the helicopter, Wagner's Flight of the Valkyries. It's a concerto, I think. It's a concerto. And it is absolutely clear. And this is like a
Just playing the Rite of the Valkyries,
like
I think.
these young boys of 20s who operate the drones through which victims are killed in Afghanistan or in Pakistan. I mean, they do it almost like as if it is a game. They are too distant from the perpetrator, from the victims to feel anything about it. It's just everyday duty. I once visited a concentration camp in I forget the name. It was in Berlin, in suburb of Berlin. Only concentration camp in Germany, one of the few, very few. And they showed us a place where they used to a room with a table and a chair, and there was a space behind the chair where somebody could, the sentry stood. They once got an order that 48,000, I think, if I'm filming the figures right, 48,000 Russian prisoners there must be liquidated. They got this order from Nazi headquarters, wherever it was. And they started this thing that people are being transferred somewhere else, everybody will have to be interviewed and removed to the other place. And once they came, and they were going to be interviewed, so they came and sat on the chair with somebody sitting, or an officer sitting in front, one or two sentences, and meanwhile the sentry standing behind with a handgun would fire on the nape and kill the man, one shot, and he was dead. And they killed 48,000 people like that. Now this is a different game altogether. This is a different, and our generation, you know, our times have specialized in that. Before Second World War, there was nothing called area bombing. The only strategic bombing. So you if a place has a military significance, you bomb that. Winston Churchill and Sir Arthur Harris developed this idea of area bombing to frighten
Dresden.
And so Dresden, Hamburg, the area bombing. Absolutely ruthless. You just, you know, bomb a city out of existence. In Hamburg, Dresden is a small city, beautiful medieval town, destroyed, with no military significance. In Hamburg, they bombed it so intensively that the streets which were made of this asphalt or whatever you call it, which caught fire. You can imagine how much heat was generated. Streets were lit up. So it is a different game. The best example is the choice of Hiroshima.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And the bombing of Nagasaki. In the case of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, both, the American army people who were in the committee, army, navy, and air force were remitted, had people represented there, and the scientists who had built the bomb. The army said that, why are you choosing Hiroshima? It has no military significance. Why not choose a city which has military significance? Why can't we wipe that out? But the scientists were insistent that it should not be a militarily significant city, because all militarily significant cities had been already been bombed, and you will not get a perfect measure of how much damage a nuclear bomb does if you build a city already partly bombed. So they chose a city which was entirely civilian population city, that. And Nagasaki was chosen. The army said that one bomb is enough, but they had developed two kinds of bomb, you know, the fat boy and something.
And little man.
So they wanted to use both to find out how that bomb will work also. The scientists could be as useless as that, more than the army people. And I get it from the autobiography of Admiral Lehigh, the naval chief who sat opposite it very clearly. So it shows this is a different kind of world we are living in. A different kind.
And quite famously, the man who flew the bomb to Hiroshima returned to finish a card game. He had left half a game behind at base, and he returned. He finished the game. Mm-hmm. He had no idea what he had done.
Right. But the lynching video, the mm-hmm. public performance of violence mm-hmm. in the lynching video. Mm-hmm. Where do you place that? What is it about us as a people that mm-hmm. makes this possible?
That's difficult to say. It shows the brutalization of the city, of the country. I mean, this is not the only case. I can give many other instances. If you read newspapers today, irrespective of what is the newspaper writing, what is hiding, what is revealing, you read, leave alone the sports page, even I would say include that, you will find, if you include in it records of crime and other kinds of hanky-panky, you will find that nearly 90% of the events relate to violence of some kind or crime of some kind. That is the fact. You know, if you just read the relevant sections of newspaper, I mean, avoid the business section where the coverage will be different, or the sports section, say, then this will be the thing. And we are getting brutalized every day. And the kind of brutalization you see is itself an indicator of how far we have fallen. I mean, I often give the example of this young boy, teenager, coming from a lower middle class family, who killed his all his siblings and his parents, own parents, father and mother. Dhananjay, I think, was the name was. What for? For getting all the money the family had. And mind you, it's a lower middle class family. The money he was going to get, it was absolutely trivial. Ultimately, he was hanged. So he didn't even get that. But that's the way it goes. That's the kind of brutalization now we are faced with. I mean, so many cases of intra-family violence which you recorded. I don't think these studies are done now. I would like to see some young people working on that, how much of the violence is within families. Killing your own wife, killing your husband, killing your own children and then committing suicide. Hey, today's newspaper, you can open it. I mean, you don't have to wait till you find such cases. Every day such cases are coming in. And it shows where we stand today. I think this brutalization is a contribution of not only this regime, it is part of a process which is going on in India over the last so many decades. And not only in India, all over the world. I mean, this regime we have now is not the only one of its kind. Everybody knows that it is part of a different set of regimes, identifiable all over the world. There is Philippines Duterte, Turkey's Erdogan, France's, what's her name, Marie Le Pen, Herder, you know, Austria. List is long. And all of them are characterized by same set of features, all of this. The only saving grace is this, that fortunately, for some reason, they have not very long shelf life. Not very long shelf life. I found my cursory look at the things, data and so on and so forth, I find that only one which lasted a little longer was Argentina's, Peronistas. That's because Peron himself died. And then Peronistas and his wife was very popular. Between them, they humanized the system a little bit, so it lasted a little longer. That's that. Otherwise, they are all, I have also hopes about the other countries which are afflicted.
But do authoritarian regimes, does one wait for them to spend themselves out, I mean, to exhaust themselves and die? Or is there a responsibility on the citizenry? What is the responsibility of the citizenry in times of an authoritarian regime?
That can never be defined because it depends on the nature of the system. I don't know. I mean, when it will come, where, how it will come, we cannot predict. People always react to this kind of systems very spontaneously. I mean, if I may say so, many of you will not like it, but the fact of the matter is this, I have seen even as ruthless a military regime as Pakistan's, in the Pakistanis have defeated four such systems without bloodshed. By mere street demonstration, they brought down four such systems. This is, I think, a global record. I mean, it can go in the Guinness Book of Records. There is something in South Asia where these authoritarian regimes do not last very long. Look at Rajapaksa of Sri Lanka. You know, such a powerful prime minister and goes out so tamely after all. You know, and said, so I cannot give a solution, but I can only tell you that it will, when it comes, it comes. But I am not a prophet. I cannot tell you how it will go.
Some years ago you said that your hope is that caste would defeat Hindutva.
Many people used to say that previously. Now it doesn't look that easy, but yes, it can still do it, because caste is not a divisive force, but caste is also a community, whether you like it or not. And often they have their own dynamics and logic. I mean, even if you are fighting against caste, you have to mobilize caste. If to say the Dalits have to be liberated from caste system, the Dalits all the while tell that. But to liberate yourself from the caste system, you have to organize them as Dalits, as a caste. So that is the logic in India. So don't forget that. And there is also the reason for that. The oppressed have to organize themselves in a community. If you want to color, I mean, the black Americans fought against the racial injustice, but they had to organize and mobilize the blacks first of all. Some whites joined it later, no doubt, but blacks had to mobilize themselves. So there is how that mobilization will come and where, it will take probably time. One of the problems of mobilizing is, of course, this, that people here in India, because our media was not diversified and decentered earlier, they have not developed a natural skepticism on media. They trust television, for example, to an extent which nobody else in the world, nowhere else in the world, people trust that much. No, the television is more important. People, even people who hate the guts of Arnab, come and tell me what Arnab did in the previous evening, because they are always on the television. And India, this also their viewing habits are also very different. For instance, surveys show that in India it is not by the program so much. A huge majority of the audience say, what do you see in television? Oh, we see something, you know, they are very vague about it. But we keep it on we put it on at 6 o'clock and switch it off at 10:30. That kind of reply. Some say it's 8 to 11, we see. It's time. So television goes on, somebody wants to see it, he or she sees it. Otherwise the television is on, like a participant in the family, as a background noise.
Ashis, with your permission, may we include the audience in this chat? If I think the first hand went up there.
So my question to you is that what? Yes, my name is Jyoti Raina. I teach in the Department of Elementary Education at Gandhi College. Three of you together have taken. for the establishment of a more inclusive, democratic, egalitarian society that fights or subverts against these forces of subversion, minoritarianism, and power?
This is a question very difficult to answer, because education is not the same for everybody. But it is true that education has increasingly become instrumental. And because the specialization begins earlier now than it used to do earlier, so there is that animal called general education or liberal education is virtually dead, or at least moribund. So those who are in the stream now give up the general education and the liberal education by the time they are in class 7 or 8 at most, then the specialization begins. And invariably that professional education is basically instrumental, and this stays with them. I was once in medical college, and I saw how people gradually get part of the professionalized, get part of the professional experience. And that kind of education does not allow us to be very optimistic, perhaps. It may be true that we have started with a pessimistic point of view, but it is also true that if you are expecting wonders from the educational system itself, you will have to think of a different kind, a more visionary educational system where children are allowed to think for themselves rather than prioritize rote learning.
Over here.
Sir, my name is Samar Singh and I study political science from Hindu College, Delhi University. Sir, my question is, nowadays, is the Hinduism as a religion is being separated from Hinduism as a philosophy? That's my question, because you told that Hinduism is too much decentralized and it will survive. But my question is, what kind of Hinduism will survive? That's my question.
What kind of Hinduism?
Will survive. Yeah, and one more question, sir, please. And you told also, sir, it's a day job where it is very difficult to identify your allies and enemy. So is it a high time to include psychology in the study of international relations, which in India we don't find much?
Coming in, I didn't get the last sentence.
So is it a high time to include psychology in the study of international relations?
To include psychology in the study of international relations.
Which we have not done in India much.
It has come elsewhere. It has not come into India because international relations become the play field of strategic studies and defense analysis. I'm sick and tired of retired generals coming and talking on the television with, with most of them have nothing to say.
Ashish ji, I'm here, Patel Bhaijan. The path we have recently taken. Khada ho jao. Budda ho. Khada hona padega. Chalo, Ashish ji, the path we have taken recent months. Will we continue on that path to leading to a Hindu state, or will we go back to what our fathers envisaged this country to be?
Depends on what kind of Hinduism we are talking about. This was, at one time we could proudly say, one religion which allowed you a different kind of approach to public affairs and public life, which in some sense celebrated diversity. I mean, everybody in India has half a dozen Ishtadeva and Ishtadevi. Your personal god and goddess, your family gods and goddesses, your caste gods and goddesses, and your regions, gods and goddesses. This was common, and exactly as you live with the diversity of divine figures, you also lived with the diversity of practices and rituals. This was a different kind of place. This is what was acceptable. It was not acceptable. People felt inferior, that other religions seemed more competent to run large systems, large states. You know, if you read, I have read RSS literature very carefully over the last 45, 50 years. If you read carefully in between lines, the RSS literature and even writings of Savarkar are so contemptuous about that Hinduism. The Hinduism which tolerates diversity, the Hinduism which speaks in 1500 languages, the Hinduism which is divided into 70,000 castes. These are estimates, all of them, nobody counted for sure, that which has 330 million gods and goddesses, 33 koti, that 330 million gods and goddesses. What kind of religion is that? They felt embarrassed. But there were people who were proud of it also. They liked that diversity, that enormous choice, individual choice they gave you. And our creative efforts mainly came from that. The India we know today, even whatever is our cultural back, basic cultural substratum of public life, it has not come from Vedas and Upanishads, though we are now trying to say that, because Vedas and Upanishads are more identifiable text. If you read the really creative minds of India, you will know that there is a recognition that it has come from medieval India, from the Puranic tradition. Not from the Shruti, but the Smarta text. Smarta text. Shruti is relevant. Out of the Sharadarshan, at least two of the darshanas, if you like, Vedanta and Buddhism, are anarchic in origin. Vedanta, everybody swears by Vedanta. That's the premium philosophical system. But Vedanta is basically anarchic. But this Hinduism, that anarchy, threatened us, a lot of Hindus, that we are not fit for the modern world. So we have tried to do better than the Vedas and the Shrutis, but maybe we have done better. But our basic substratum comes from the Puranic tradition. You know, and this is our strength. Because in Puranic tradition, the contribution is not only from the Hindus, but from all religions. All the Sikhism, Islam, they're all there somehow. And vice versa. Amir Khusro could write the lines in his lyrics, which are perfectly evocative of the Vaishnava tradition. Is talking of Radha's separation from Krishna. So that play you have, that is the source of creativity, because creativity requires a certain contact zone. Whole of India is a contact, whole of India, whole of South Asia is a contact zone, where we have traditionally meet at every state a different kind of other, I am saying, between different kind of cultural stratum, different kind of gods and goddesses, different kind of traditions, and we have lived with that, and we have learned to tolerate diversity, not tolerate, we have learned to celebrate diversity. Now, this is our...
You were talking about psychology and saying that, you know, more or less everybody around the world has the same psychology mentally.
I didn't say that.
Okay.
But that's one of the claims of psychology, yeah. That it is, psychology is universal.
Yeah.
I mean, in some sense it is.
But yet you said that the cultural habits of Indians and some other habits of Indians are different from rest of the world. So my question is, what makes us different from rest of the world?
That's what I'm specifying out, exactly. So that's what I'm specifying.
Professor Nandy, if a large majority sees a regime as efficient and a small section sees it as authoritarian, how are public demonstrations to happen? I'm saying you talked about authoritarian regimes and you mentioned how even Pakistan brought three or four authoritarian regimes down through public demonstrations. My question is, or rather my disagreement is, that those regimes were perceived as authoritarian regimes. But if a large majority sees a regime as an efficient one and not as an authoritarian one, how is public outrage or public demonstration to happen? How are those regimes to be even brought down when there is such a context of collaboration?
I don't think recognition of it as an authoritarian regime in any case it separates it from the reason. Because all people are intelligent enough to know what is authoritarian and what is not, you know. But people often also enjoy that, their sense of security and a sense of what I might call a search for a pseudo community. Now, in Hindutva gives you a pseudo community. This is your one community. Whereas Hinduism doesn't give you that feeling, it gives you only an ambience in which you are allowed a choice. So there your security is much less because you know from the beginning that it is relevant for only some and you have your choice, you have the freedom, the choice of freedom, but your efficiency will be less. It is true. Let us not deny that. It is true that if India had one language, then India would have been more efficient. In fact, our census from 1940s onwards have been trying to reduce the number of languages. So, while counting, they count dialects and languages. Now, Hindi is at the moment a collection of 66 languages, of which the mainstream Hindi, which came in from the Gangetic plain in central India, you know, is probably in a minority. Why probably? It is in a minority. And it is also only that Hindi which we speak is only less than 100 years old. Whereas, as Maithili and Bhojpuri are two dialects of Hindi which have histories of more than 1,000 years. You have to think of that. So we are also looking for the single language, one language, Hindustani. Yeah? We are looking for that. So there is always, because that will be more efficient. So the one census was taken and it came out that there are 1500 languages in India. Now they don't count again, they had gone back to this dialect business and all that, so the number language are less. And a people's survey of available languages in India done by Ganesh Devi and his associates, done 1.5 years ago, 2 years ago, finds that there are 1200 languages in India. In the last 40 or 45 years, we have lost 300 languages. Indians should be happy and those who seek efficiency should be happier. But each language is a worldview also. It's also a philosophy of life. I think there is some loss also in it. It may not be as much of a loss as many think it would be, but it is a loss nonetheless. And there is no harm these languages have done. They have no harm. you know, people, because everybody talks in India number of languages. You are Anantamurthy used to tell me that the Bangalore rickshawalas, they all spoke 5 or 6 languages. Five or six languages. But now that the children get educated, they are learning less and less languages, and that their skill in language skills are diminishing. Now, it is for you to decide whether you think you are happier with that or unhappy with that. My feeling is this, that if Switzerland, which is smaller than Kerala in population, has 4 national languages, then we also have 30 national languages. Our constitution tells that, 30 national languages. And what's the harm in it? Why should we feel embarrassed about it? Nepal has 4 national languages, including Bhojpuri, Maithili and Hindi. Nepali, of course, is also, but 4 national languages. Why we are embarrassed by that? I think this is a search for, a kind of unification. For I am not great. I cannot consider it a great gain. I mean, it is like Singapore imposing Mandarin on all the Chinese because Mandarin more prestigious than Hakka or some whatever they were to speak earlier. They are Chinese. They are speaking Chinese, but that didn't satisfy Mr. Lee Kuan Yew. He was looking for efficiency. So they are all speaking Mandarin now. They all speak badly, I guess.
Professor Nandy, Nalini Singh is my name. Sir, would you say that democracy is receding, let's say, from the country, from our country? Is it sort of atrophy? Is it in that stage when you can sense atrophy? And just very tangentially, when you're speaking of the media, it is said that today, very big people in the country don't need the media. The media needs them. So if you can combine the two.
Very true. You are right. We were talking about this before this meeting started, that one of the reasons is this, that previously those who owned large media, media houses, also had other businesses, and they were much more important than the media business. Times of India Group always had a huge business in jute, sugar. I didn't know the sugar, but
they even had a bank.
So they had. Now, Times of India itself is the largest. So the importance of that newspaper has gone up in many cases. So therefore, have to protect the newspaper and obey the diktats. There is.
The big people in the country have become so big that they are able to connect without the media, without the medium of the media, that in fact the media needs them because for the reasons that you just said. But also on democracy, is it receding, would you say?
There is rumor going on that one of the large industrial houses now owns something like shares in something like 75% of the media. How true or false, I do not know, but this is the rumor I hear of. Not always with having a majority share, but even if a very large industrial house is involved, even a minority share has a certain kind of impact.
You clearly spoke a lot about Gandhiji, and just now you mentioned you are Anantamurthy. Anantamurthy once in one of his essays referred to Gandhi as the critical insider, as a critical insider, which basically means that he lived within the Indian tradition, but he was also critical of it. And in today's, in contemporary India, is it possible at all to imagine a critical insider? Because if you are critical, you are designated the outsider. And if you're an insider, you can't be critical.
This is not only a failure of leadership, it is a failure of us to some extent. The very fact that we had not, we have not able to kind of contain that this kind of identification of consent with absence of criticism is a development which I think is sad, but it is, I think, also to some extent something which the Indian middle classes have brought upon itself. In society like ours, the middle class has always been a mediating factor. We respond to new ideas, we respond to criticisms, we offer criticisms, there are counter criticisms from the other side, and this has always been a thriving, living middle class. But now, a very significant proportion of the middle class technically has grown since the time of independence, 6 times its older size, 50 million to something like 300 million now. That's the rough estimate, very crude estimate. But I would suspect that only a small minority is a natural outgrowth of the middle class we had at the time of independence, a small middle class. So maybe instead of 50 million, it is now 100 million, maybe 150 million. But the rest are, they're middle class by virtue of money, not virtue of middle class values. They are not accustomed to having a middle class which speaks out. It's a middle class which is moving with whatever is in the air. You know, whoever can mobilize themselves better through the media, that's not a middle class. There is no skepticism, no robust skepticism of the kind we saw an earlier middle class. You know, I was sued once for saying that the Gujarati middle class has become communalized. No, I have lived in Gujarat. I speak Gujarati. I can read and read Gujarati. I have fondness for Gujarati. I have also a wife who is Gujarati. But this is absurd. This is absurd that they sued me for hurting the sentiments of the middle class. It is the job of a writer to hurt the sentiments of the middle class. When I was a child in school, our prescribed text included a piece by Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyay, writer of Vande Mataram, called Babu. Babu is a savage attack on the Bengali middle class. It was a compulsory reading. 150 years it has remained a part of textbooks in Bengal. But there are parts of India where this kind of tradition has not grown. It's a pity. It's a great pity that people are getting more and more we're getting more and more middle class who are unexpected to the idea of criticism. Criticism is like a dangerous thing. Criticism like you are not agreeing with the majority. And that's a great pity. In this culture, you know, in this civilization, I think at least that was once the running theme, that everybody has an independent view of them. Anyway, then.
Can I clarify something? That that business of the middle class multiplying 6 times over, the metric is based on consumption alone. What goods are being consumed and to what extent are they being? For instance, in the 90s, one of the defining criteria for being middle class was to be was to use a twin track razor rather than an open blade razor. You know, traditional. It was seriously. Twin track razor. You know, the modern razors that we use. Do you use that or do you use the traditional razor?
Okay, sir, since you mentioned the prescribed textbooks, just one question. Say, hypothetically speaking, 20 years, 30 years from now, if the children are to sit in a history classroom and read the five reasons, five causes for the rise of nationalism in this period that we are living through, and given the state of our education, they've got to get all those 5 points correct to get those 5 out of 5 right. What, in your view, would be those 5 points that the child could quote? the rise of, and assuming we are past the Achhe Din days and we are in a more tolerant sort of society, what would those 5 points be?
5 points?
Yes.
Of what?
For the rise of nationalism.
Nationalism. I think this idea that, I think there are many reasons, I can think of many, but I think the primary reason is this, that we have lost the right to our future. Only from robust skepticism and mutual criticism and cross-criticisms can we have a variety of futures to opt for. But now everybody knows that the dominant concept of the future has been determined, that India has to be powerful, developed, superpower, fully armed, and absolutely like a conventional nation state of Europe, especially Europe in the 20th century, because many of the European states are moving away from that concept of nation state, though some are sticking to it. And in this situation, we have lost the right to define our future. Our future is nothing but what is the present of the today's West. I mean, I often mention, Oscar Wilde said once, that a virtuous Indian, when he dies now, does not go to heaven, he goes to New York.
So that's a wonderful last line to end the evening on. Thank you so much, Professor Nandy. And I will invite our chief editor, Raj Kamal Jha, to present a memento to Professor Nandy.
So please sit.